like to breeze right into our next segment. That's session four. We're going to be taking a look at case studies of flash drought. And I'd like to invite Carson McPherson-Kretzky to come up with me. We're going to kind of share some duties here for this particular session. But as she comes up, I'll introduce her background. She's a research associate at the Natural Hazards Center at the University of Colorado Boulder, whose research focuses on investigating the factors that influence preparedness and assessing which risk communication strategies are most effective at motivating people. Kind of a theme we're hearing this morning. And Carson is also a member of the NIDAS Flash Drought Working Group. So please welcome Carson.
Thank you, Sylvia. And so happy to be here today and helping to moderate this next session. So this session is really focusing on case studies. So the presenters are going to showcase regional responses to flash drought events, the successes, the challenges, and some of the lessons learned from their experience. And the way that this is going to work is we're going to have four different presentations. We're going to start, and they're going to each be about 12 minutes long with a few minutes for questions after each presentation. We're going to have the first two, then we're going to have a little bit of a break, come back, hear the second two, and then we're going to do a bit of an interactive activity. So there won't be as much time for questions at the end to the presenter. So if you want to ask your questions, do it after their presentations. So we are going to go ahead and start with Vandana Rao, who is the director of the water policy in the Massachusetts Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs. She is going to be talking about on a path to better drought preparedness. So Vandana, come on up.
Thank you. Appreciate being asked to come and speak about drought in the Northeast. And yes, of course, we do have droughts in the Northeast. Is this not working? There. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of background on how we approach drought, what our drought declaration looks like in Massachusetts, and what we've been doing over the last, I would say, 6 to 7 years on learning from some of our recent droughts and trying to address them more in a timely manner. So we have quite a process in Massachusetts to assess droughts, monitor the data and look at the data, as well as declare droughts. So I just want to quickly go through, I know I have only 12 minutes, so it's going to be a quick one, but we have 6 indices that we look at. We're in the process of replacing our crop moisture index, which we found wholly unsuitable for Massachusetts, to using eddy instead to really get the evapotranspiration aspect. So these 6 are our very solid data-oriented indices that we look at. In addition, we also do consider information such as temperature, recent weather events, what's going to happen as a forecast in the next week or 10 days, snowpack status, drought outlook, stream flow forecasts, et cetera, as well as impacts. I think our look at how the drought is faring really likes to take into consideration on the ground impacts that we're getting and hearing from the public and people who are part of our drought task force. So Massachusetts has a drought task force that was set up to really pull together scientists, researchers in state agencies, federal agencies, as well as practitioners who are really dealing with the data and the impacts. So we've tried to keep this away from any political influence, which can happen, but really look at the science, look at the data, what is it telling us? And for us to opine on what the drought condition is for a particular period of time. So the drought task force, when we are in a drought, meets at least once a month. And we have the option of considering various regional scales. When I say regional scales, it is Massachusetts. So these are small regions. As you can see at the map on the right there, we have a demarcation of the regions. We have 7 regions within the state. Each of them actually do behave a little differently from the other when we are in a drought. So we have the ability to look at it from that regional perspective, but also can look at smaller delineations at a county scale, at a watershed scale, if conditions at those smaller scales are significantly different from what's happening in the rest of the region. So the recommendation goes from our drought task force to the Secretary of Energy and Environmental Affairs. And the secretary really is the person that has the ability to declare the drought for the state. None of this is in any piece of legislation. We're doing it as good policy, as something we should be doing. It's the right thing to do. It's a process that's been set up and I think working really well now for the last 20 years. Okay, so everything started for us, really precipitated in 2016. I wanted to give you a sense of how this drought progressed through in Massachusetts. I came into the drought picture really at the summer of 2016. I spent July of 2016 in India visiting my parents during the monsoon. It rained every single day. And that particular year, Mumbai, the city that I visited, received 3,000 almost millimeters of rain, 118 inches of rain in 3 months. So here I was kind of drenched in or drowning in rain during my vacation to come back to Massachusetts to be hit by what we see in that first map, which is July 2016. Two of our regions were at level zero the previous month, and already we saw a level two in July. Really rapid onset, so we thought. Or perhaps we missed the signals from what was going on in the previous months, which is, I think, more likely the case. But as we progressed through the months, our drought did move pretty rapidly and stayed at a level three out of four levels for a significant number of months through the summer and the fall. So this had a lot of impacts for us in many ways, and I'll come to that in just a minute. And so this is the part that really gave us a lot of heartburn. We missed this drought and it progressed really rapidly. So we ended up then revising our drought plan. We didn't think our plan was really responsive to us. What we were seeing on the ground is more frequent and intense droughts. So we needed something that really provided an early signal. It gave us a better sense of what this intensification looked like. It also, we were looking for a methodology that provided us with a sense of severity. Our earlier approach was just number of months below normal. If we were 2 months below normal, it was at some level. If it was 4 or 5 months below normal, it was at another level, and so on. And that doesn't really tell you much about how severely below normal it is. So we really needed some metrics and thresholds that gave us that information. You'll see those thresholds at the table on the right, similar to what the US Drought Monitor also does. So we now have four levels, and we changed our nomenclature to give a better sense and to communicate better what that drought really means. We first had things like warning, watch, and as you know, many of these terms that all of you are familiar with, but those don't tell us anything about a condition we're in now. They tell us about something that is imminent to come, just by the way those words are, the terms of how they're used in popular culture. So we changed the description to include mild drought, significant drought, critical drought, and emergency drought. And we feel like those terms give a better sense to municipalities, to water users, that in terms of how intensive that drought is. We've operationalized the drought plan by tying it to our emergency management agencies, comprehensive emergency management plan for the state. We've added a lot more actions on preparedness and response and guidance to communities on how to prepare well before a drought is in place, and as well as what happens once you're in a drought. All right, so we felt good about our new plan. We were hoping we wouldn't have to test it out for many years, like the earlier plan. We'd really didn't test it for another 10 or 15 years. But in another year or so, we faced with yet another drought. 2020, 2021 was another drought, and there were lots of lessons that we learned during the course of this drought as well as after the fact. And this is how the drought progressed. So I wanted to point a few things to you. One, June 26, 2020, boom, four regions in the state are at level two. And this was not for a lack of identifying the conditions. It really was a rapid onset. We felt confident about our methodology and data and knew that the previous month we were starting to see dry conditions, but very rapidly these four regions moved into a significant drought stage. You'll see in the July map, the Southeast region was still at a level zero, and then in August, it's at a level two. So lots of these areas where within that drought, certain regions have moved and responded much more rapidly. In addition, if you look at the October and November maps, what we also found is within these small regions, relatively speaking, there were certain areas within those regions or certain basins that really responded very differently. And conditions were much more intensive and moved more rapidly than the rest of the region. And for the first time ever, our state really declared a watershed drought. So we specifically called a drought at that level for a particular watershed. Never have done that before. It was certainly something that our Secretary of Environmental Affairs felt strongly that we need to recognize these fast deteriorating conditions, and especially the type of ecological and stream flow impacts it's having in those areas, and call it for what it is, and not let the condition of the rest of the region mask what is happening in this particular watershed. Again, another drought in 2022, some similar things here as well. And what we did differently in this drought is actually have more frequent meetings. It was something that our governor called for, our Secretary for Environment was very interested and asked for us to look at the drought on a more frequent basis. So you'll see, I put the meeting dates here. We sort of met every 2 weeks for some period of time. Heck of a lot of work, so much pressure on the staff to pull all of this together. And frankly, we don't have the data everywhere we don't have real-time data everywhere to monitor on a bi-weekly basis. We still do monthly tape down measurements for some of our groundwater wells. Our reservoir levels also come on a monthly basis. So how then can we do bi-weekly analysis of how those areas are faring? We had to ask staff to put an extra time to go and do these off-cycle measurements. So it takes a lot of effort to come up with or assessing conditions when you don't have real-time data. But we somehow pulled it off with the recognition that not all the data is there. But yet, as you can see, between June and August, every 2 weeks, it was worthwhile for us meeting because the drought really advanced very rapidly. And you can see those changes, and it went to a critical level three, which is just one level short of an emergency. We also, in our September meeting, wanted to highlight certain areas where we are seeing some faster or worse conditions. It wasn't enough for us to make a drought call for those watersheds, but it's part of the communication to the public that, oh, this region is doing okay, or is at X level of drought, but this coastal region is particularly being impacted. And we had that being outlined in our press releases and in any conversations we had with press. All right, so I wanted to quickly kind of pivot to some of the impacts. We've heard a lot, and there were lots of conversations yesterday about impacts. What we have been finding, and perhaps it's been exacerbated by the fast moving nature of the droughts we're seeing, is that our stream flow and groundwater are seeing particularly low levels, in fact, record lows. And if we compare what we saw in 2016 and 2020, lots of wells and stream gauges have shown record low flows and record low levels. And if you compare it to our drought of record, which is the 1960s drought that lasted in Massachusetts from anywhere from 5 to 7 years, it's considered as the 1 in 500 year drought. In 2016, we should not have seen those low levels because that drought should have had the lowest levels of stream flow and groundwater. Yet in those very same, you know, we have gauges that go back 120, 140 years. So we have data where we can compare through the many other droughts over the course of the last century. We saw lower levels in 2016, and we saw lower levels in 2020 as well. So that's very concerning for us, that clearly something else is going on besides land use impacts. I think this fast moving droughts are certainly having those impacts. And then can't talk about drought these days, even in Massachusetts, without fire danger, firefighting. Both these photos are from Massachusetts, the one at the bottom. That fire lasted over a month. And why it's important, it causes damage, economic damage. It can, people have to leave their homes, et cetera. But where is the water coming from to put these fires out? Typically our firefighters for wildfires are looking in the wild for natural water bodies to get water from. These are dry in a drought. And so they go to the public water supply system. those are overstretched, often because many communities continue to water outdoors during a drought. And so there are issues of not enough pressure in their system or just not enough volume to put out fires. So this is some of the things that we never thought we'd have to deal with in Massachusetts. We're starting to see more of and are certainly part of our communication. Can I ask how many minutes I have? I want to make sure I run through them quickly. So we're adapting. We're constantly learning from the three droughts that we've already had. We're starting to put in more real-time data. Of course, that means getting more funding. Do we have it? No, I keep asking for it. Sometimes I do get it. We were able to get about 200,000 extra in our budget each year. We now have over $1 million for our network, but we need more. Our CRN wells will all be real time within the next several months to within a year. We have a new drought dashboard, thanks to Art and his team that we worked closely with to set up an automated dashboard that provides us with information. This has saved us tremendous staff time, at least 2 days of work before each task force meeting, where we can get data on a monthly and a weekly basis if we can. We do now sub-regional and watershed analysis each time, and we're also performing a network analysis with our USGS. Quickly, we have a water impact reporter that we put out last year. We want to hear from the public in Massachusetts. And finally, we've put things into regulation. Nobody does anything by just encouraging them. And this table here was part of our drought plan. It was an encouragement. It was something we put out in press releases. But in January of this year, we passed new regulations that applied these outdoor watering restrictions and then a few more conditions onto a good portion of our water suppliers, water users, public water supply systems. Not all, we still have a patchwork of regulations, but this was a huge, huge deal, a big win for us. Water suppliers are suing us. Many of them are taking us to court on this, but nevertheless, the regulations stand as of now. Okay, so what are we doing? Lots of communication. We've realized that just by us sitting in our rooms, assessing the drought is not enough. We have to let people know what the conditions are and what it means to them. So we started with issuing a drought alert. And when we are in a level 2 or more significant drought, it's a one pager, it's a PDF or a JPEG that we've sent around to everybody we know, from municipal officials, public health officials, boards of health, regional planning agencies, environmental groups, other state agencies, et cetera. So that's something that gives it in a snapshot. We've had lots of virtual meetings with stakeholders. Think of any stakeholder group that you can think of. We've connected with them through our agencies that work with them, as well as through their representative groups. We've had highway signs on our major highways, lots of web updates and press releases and conversations with the press galore. I mean, I don't know how many folks I talked to on the media, and they are picking up this. They were picking up this very well last year. All right, the other thing we've done is created lots of social media ready products. So these are all infographics. Part of this is to educate the public about why water supply is important, how the water they're taking from their well or when they open the tap is connected to things like fire or the drought, how their water rates are connected to all of this. And so we've worked in the last few years with a design firm to put out some of these social media posts, tips for saving water, and we encourage our water suppliers to use them. You know, so we are not the only ones that are out there with this message. And we've seen many water suppliers put it on their social media platforms, as well as in other communication. We've created these on the right that you see, several different types of water saver tips, depending on time of year. And these in particular were created with some close coordination with our water suppliers. So we asked them, what do you need? What kind of things are you seeing in your communities that people aren't listening to? Or you feel you need to address a particular type of issue. And so these are hot off the press. We just put these out within the last few weeks. And finally, some of those issues that I talked about in terms of fire danger and flushing, and even that figure that you see on the left, that was particularly important for us to create because several times in the last few years, while we've been in a drought, we've had a huge downpour. We've had floods, and those photos that you see in the left there are from the city of Worcester in October 2016, when they were in a level 3 drought. They got one weekend of intense rainfall that flooded most of the city. And so most people think, oh, the drought is done. And as we all know, it isn't. And the drought lasted even in that region for many months after that. So it is important for us to message these correctly to the public, to sort of bring them along with us as to why we're putting in restrictions, why we're asking them to do the types of things they need to do to be careful about their outdoor fires, et cetera. So, all right, that's all I have. Hopefully that was rapid enough, some resources and yep, thank you.
All right, can you guys hear me on here? So we probably have time for maybe one quick question for Vandana. So if anyone wants to ask a question, I'm really impressed by your communication levels that you've come out with and how you're mapping that onto all of the materials that you're creating. That's really great. Yeah.
We were able to get some funding, which was a task in itself to hire a consulting company to do that.
Yeah, this is really fantastic. Great presentation. A question hypothetically.
Yep.
So Massachusetts goes 20 years without another drought. How do you plan on keeping up the focus on preparation for the next drought when you go multi-years without a drought, perhaps even having more flooding events?
Yeah, I mean, so early 2000s, we had a drought, and then the next significant drought was in 2016. 15 years, we didn't really have much to speak of. And yeah, apathy can set in, right? But I think now we have a really good plan. We have a good methodology. We monitor this every month, and we have hydrological conditions report that monitor this every month and bring to our Water Resources Commission. So in terms of tracking what's happening, we're doing a good job. In terms of planning and ensuring that the water users on the other end are also doing what they need to do, I would say I would put our users in two buckets, one the ag side and the water supply side. On the ag side, we have been able to make about $2 million available to make our agriculture or our farms more water efficient so that they can put those in place. So drought or no drought, they're using water efficiently. So even in a normal year, we want them to be using it efficiently, right? So that is in place. And on the water supply side, you know, we have quite a lot of regulations for our water supply community, which is probably why they're suing us. But so we have these conditions that are tied to drought, but we also have conditions on water use tied to stream flow or groundwater levels. So when streams go below a certain level, they have to put in restrictions. So even if it's not a drought, but a normal year with some fluctuations, we do that. And some communities feel that they don't want to look at stream flow every 2 weeks to see, has it gone up, has it come down, what's happening, you know, and keep changing the message. So they just put in restrictions for the entire summer. So I think some of that will help us in ensuring that we're using water efficiently and minimizing at least our human impact to it. We're also encouraging communities to have drought plans. And I think I heard a term yesterday saying water shortage plan or something like that. And I really like the way that was framed rather than a drought management plan, because that tends to conflict with the state drought plan, like who trumps who, what happens first, second. So I think a water shortage plan is a good way to do it, because it could be shortages because of water quality issues, but they are having the same kinds of restrictions and actions that they can take at the local level to plan for that. So we're hoping we don't sleep between droughts. But I think some of the things that we have learned have set in motion some of our actions to help us better prepare for the next one, which may be this year. I hope not.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Vandana. All right. So next up, we have Elliot Wickham, who is the Water Resources Climatologist in South Carolina State Climatology Office within the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. He'll be talking about flash drought in South Carolina, overcoming barriers through investments and relationships, collaboration, and communication.
Okay. I'll try and boogie here. Thank you for giving me time to speak. So we've talked a lot about lemons to lemonades this last couple of days. South Carolina has definitely had some lemons that we've had to go through, and we're working on perfecting our lemonade recipe with that. So some background with the South Carolina Climate Office and drought monitoring prior to 2019. First barrier that we kind of face is that the Climate Office is in the Department of Natural Resources. We are separate from the Department of Ag in South Carolina and Clemson Extension. So when we're communicating with them, it's not necessarily in-house, it's any partnerships that we've built. And then with the South Carolina Drought Response Committee, the state task force, the South Carolina Office, Climate Office is the lead for that. And the main focus of that task force is working with municipal water supplies to make sure that they have enough water, recommending non-essential water use curtailment. So agriculture comes to the table on that, but the outcomes of those meetings is not really ag focused. And then with the US Drought Monitor, we had limited involvement prior to 2019. One of the barriers with this was we were generally slower and infrequent to the table with the USDM when we were participating, which is not ideal for agriculture or for flash droughts. And so drought monitoring in the state was at the time a little bit less focused on ag in terms of what their needs were. So in 2016, I will say that this drought, you could say, was potentially flashy, although we don't necessarily in our state call it that way. But the 2016 drought, so September into November in the upstate, conditions were getting worse through this period. In the coastal plain, you can see specifically on the map on the right, it's a blank map. The reason for that is we had Hurricane Matthew come through. So we call this the time when half the state was in drought and half the state was flooding. So the SCO, our focus was primarily on the drought task force, what we were doing for that regarding drought, the flooding in the coastal plain, so getting pulled in two different directions. Ag component of it wasn't necessarily our focus. Here we have the Pinnacle Mountain Fire that happened in the upstate, one of the worst, largest wildfires we had, and it happened just before this map in November. So one of the fallouts with this is the ag community was not super happy with the South Carolina Climate Office after that. Then moving forward, 2019, this was a drought that when I get to, we've talked about it before from Klaus and Pam from Georgia and North Carolina. 2019, May and June, our office started to get a little bit more involved with the drought monitor. The assistant state climatologist was the one that was taking the lead on that. In July, her and someone from the Department of Ag at the South Carolina worked on creating outreach materials or a pamphlet for like the Seymour tool. I'll show that in a bit. September, the assistant state climatologist and Department of Ag went to the USDM forum to learn more about the process of the US drought monitor, getting involved with that. And wouldn't you know it, right after they get back from that, we enter a flash drought. Another barrier we had with this is the assistant climatologist was thrown into the process of the USDM without having a background in drought monitoring or just in general what the USDM process is about. So again, 2019 drought, we have about a month period, we have multiple places, specifically in the upstate, that go from a 2 or 3 level degradation in about a 4-week period. So this is the pamphlet that I was talking about, the original Seymour pamphlet that we put out with Department of Ag, trying to get it out to farmers and producers as much as possible. And they get a hold of it in 2019, specifically with the flash drought that takes place, or 2019, excuse me. And this is just an example report from how bad the soil moisture was up in Pickens County at the time. So moving forward, after the 2019 and 2016 droughts, ag feels like they're kind of underrepresented in drought in South Carolina. The agricultural community then pushes for a person to be on the USDM, really looking at that every week. And so talking about barriers for a while, we finally start to hit a first success. The SEO gets dedicated funding. Again, RARE, we just talked about that, from Massachusetts, gets funding for a climatologist to lead the USDM process in South Carolina. And that's what my role is. I started in 2020. And so my job weekly, I communicate with different state and federal entities in South Carolina, as well as our surrounding states. So the state level, it's generally Clemson Extension, Department of Ag, DNR Hydrology, National Weather Service, USGS, NRCS, and more recently, FSA. And like I said, North Carolina and Georgia every week. So working with FSA, it's really started last year in 2020 or 2022. They reach out to me. They were aware of that pamphlet that came out, and they wanted a copy of it. We had updated it since. There's time and resources for someone to work on this and update it. Specifically, the update that we made was not just how to report, but how you can put the information on your phone in terms of the CMOR app, and then upload condition reports in the field instead of having to go back to your computer if you wanted to do that. They liked this so much that it is now in every FSA county office across the state. After that, we did a presentation. I came to one of their meetings and did a presentation on how the USDM process works, what my role is, what I do, and what I'm looking at, and how they can participate in that. And so this is, I will say, I think I stole this from Deb Bathke at the USDM, or at the National Mitigation Center, showing just all the different inputs, showing this to them that it is a robust and but also a complicated process, and that just because it's dry on your farm does not mean that it's automatically gonna be D2 conditions. And one of the eye-openers that came out of this was that we don't have a lot of soil moisture network or sensors in our state. We have two scan networks and that's it. So I have modeled data that I can look at, but in terms of what's actually happening on the ground, I'm flying blind a little bit. And so we have that conversation during this meeting that their reports, when they're giving me information, that really helps with telling me what's actually happening and inserting this into this data. So we went over a little bit what happened in 2022 with FSA. In early June, some more communication came out with Clemson Extension regarding the CMOR tool. And we went through a flash drought in June of last year. During this time, we got more CMOR reports from Clemson Extension, which was very helpful. But also during this period, the FSA reports, they started coming in, and they came in a lot, which was very helpful from looking at the indicators that were starting to rapidly deteriorate. So I say flash drought, it happened rapidly, but it wasn't quite as bad as everyone remembers in 2016. So if I said that to somebody in my state, the 2022 flash drought, they'd probably look at me like I was crazy. So I say be careful what you ask for. I'm so happy that FSA gave all these reports during the time that I asked for them. But I remember specifically on June 28th, I was sitting in a meeting. It was an initial meeting that we were having for a River Basin Council, and I didn't get to attend because I spent the whole time looking at indicators, looking at reports from FSA with them on the phone, figuring out what we needed to do. So we set up this relationship, and they were really good about sending in indicators for when I, or reports and impacts for when I needed them, and then also pushing producers to give me information, not just go through them, but they were fine giving out my contact information so they could call me and provide what information was going on their farm. So I have some pictures here of things that came in around the 28th, corn stress, soil moisture. They said that was a stream. I don't know what it looked like before, but they said that was a stream. And then a depleted pond in Edgefield County there. So where we're at now, March of 2023, I'm working with them, and we came up with a way that we just want to simply get information kind of on a weekly basis for what's going on in the different counties. So we put up a quick survey. I think it's either Google or Microsoft form. What is happening in your area, wet or dry, based on the Seymour components in terms of the levels that there are. What are the crop conditions? What are the pasture conditions? And then a comment section. It's pretty simple. It comes to me in an Excel form, but I get this now every week of just where they're at the county in terms of dry, wet, and what it's looking like for their crops. And for me, this helps provide regular ground truthing, what's happening on the ground compared to the different metrics that I'm looking at, provides context to the indicators I'm looking at. And then it also provides changes over time. So how dry are things waffling back and forth? They continually getting dry, continually getting wet. So where are we, the 1 minute, all right. Barriers and successes. We were focused more on the state process rather than the USDM. And now we have someone working on the USDM, and we're looking at agricultural and flash drought problems in the state regularly. We weren't connected really with agriculture too much before, but now with the partnership with FSA, we have that on a weekly communication level, and that helps with ground truthing things such as not having soil moisture network in our state. So overall, we've increased drought monitoring frequency with weekly input to the USDM. We forged strong partnerships with FSA for agricultural conditions and reports through frequent communication. These two approaches not only work to capture agricultural drought conditions, but also works as a collaborative monitoring approach for flash drought or rapidly deteriorating conditions. And I would like to say that this really wouldn't be possible if you didn't have the resources or the human capital for the interest and the want to make sure that we're capturing things as in real time as possible, what's happening on the ground. And then where I'd like to go, using this as an agricultural early warning drought system, just looking at what those reports are saying and where we're going, keeping an eye on that. Specifically, again, when I'm looking at model data rather than what's actually happening on the ground. And then being able to potentially, if we get enough of this data, to use it to tie it to indicators, what matters for agriculture at different times of the year for the different indicators in our state. So hopefully I didn't go too far over, but that's my talk. So.
Elliot, we have time for a question or two, one question. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Brian Fuchs with the National Drought Mitigation Center again. So the reporting that you're getting from your FSA folks following the Seymour format, mm-hmm. does that get into Seymour so it's archived so anyone can see it, or is that only getting across to your desk?
Right now it's just my desk. So we're having these conversations with them as this is like a new thing. We're kind of at this crossroads of, you know, I think in a perfect world, we'd like to just have it be the Seymour aspect so that anyone can see it and it's right there for the weekly component. But we also kind of thought too that with those Seymour, I mean, with the Seymour tool, it is up to your discretion how much detail or not detail you want to put in there. But we didn't want to, since the FSA county agents are so busy, we didn't want to necessarily scare them away with like throwing this huge, potentially huge thing at them that they felt like they had to answer every week. And so we were like, while we're getting this off the ground, let's at least just start it with simple Google form, just where are you at, and then having this information. And then, we're going to have conversations going forward about like, how do we want to do this? Because even we already know, like right now, this is great for just like a quick and dirty what's going on. But like, what do we do when things start getting beyond mildly dry and it's moderately or because the form we have now is not necessarily set up.
The reason, and again, I bring it up because the photos you showed, your comment even was, well, this is supposed to be a stream. I don't know what it's supposed to look like, but if you have regular reporting and it's getting archived, then you can go back and look. And again, as a drought monitor author or others, we could tap into that as well. And, you know, if Elliot's gone for the week, is someone else going to be sharing that information, or are we going to have access to it? So that's the benefit of using the national network, I guess. That's just my only comment.
No, we've thought about it. We're just kind of like, how do we get it going correctly? Yeah. So thank you.
And maybe you could use some university students who like programming and want to help connect the dots.
Yeah. Well, we're not tied with a university either. So we have to like
partnership opportunity.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we're running a little bit over. So what is our plan for break?
I think we're going to have to come back at 10:30. We're cutting the break just a little bit short. So 15 minutes, if you could be back in plenary, that'd be great.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, Elliot. All right, folks, the time is now 10:30. So grab your colleagues who are out in the hallway and bring them back, and we'll get started in just a minute. Hello. Okay, we're going to get going here in a moment. So folks who are out in the lobby, come back on in. All right, so we have our virtual presenter joining us for this next one. We have Karen Bimbacco, who is the Washington State Assistant State Climatologist and is located in Seattle at the University of Washington. And go ahead, Karen. She's going to be talking about drought in the Pacific Northwest in 2021, a different flavor.
Great. Can you hear me okay? I'm going to assume yes. So thanks for having me this morning. I'm sorry I can't be with you all in person. So I first want to acknowledge my colleagues, Jacqueline and Danny at the Washington State Department of Agriculture, who put together the second half of this talk. So I'm just going to dive right in here and talk a little bit about some of our historical droughts in Washington State. So what you're seeing here is just one sort of measure of drought. Our temperature and precipitation anomalies averaged across Washington State in some of our recent droughts. The first two, 1977 and 2001, you can see here were really driven by a dry winter conditions. So you can see below normal precipitation throughout the winter that severely impacted the state. These are also known as dry snow droughts. 2015 was a bit different. So what sticks out to me here are those really warm temperature anomalies throughout the whole year. And that's what caused our precipitation to fall more as rain rather than snow. And that drove our drought. You can see in the precipitation anomalies that, it was a bit on the drier side when you look at across the state as a whole, but it was really that lack of snowpack, or otherwise known as a warm snow drought, that caused our statewide drought there. 2015 remains our warmest year on record for Washington State. And then something else to know about Washington is we have a drought definition written in our state statute that is defined as water supply, either below or projected to be below 75% of normal, with undue hardship to people, farms, or fish also expected. So these first three droughts highlighted here, 1977, 2001, and 2015, really fit with that Washington State drought definition that's focused on water supply. And then we see 2021, and this is a totally different flavor. You can see our warm anomalies throughout most of the year, but what really stands out is that 6-month period of below normal spring and summer precipitation. So just to set the stage, and I won't spend a ton of time on this here, this is our October through March precipitation percent of normal for that winter 2020 to 2021. And you can see that it was mostly normal to above normal precipitation. And importantly, in our mountain regions too, we had normal precipitation. By April 1, our snowpack was normal to above normal throughout most of the state. Also notable here, as you can see in British Columbia, which feeds the Columbia River, had normal to above normal snowpack for 2021. So with our recent history of water supply and snowpack droughts, we seem to be in really good shape at this point in the season. There is some below normal winter precipitation in the lower Columbia Basin, but really the good snowpack resulted in, we didn't have much concerns at this point. But then we shifted into spring. And so this is a long time series of Washington March through May precipitation. And you can see that 2021 was our second driest March through May on record, with only 44% of normal precipitation. It was pretty extreme in that anomaly there. And for myself personally, the impact of a dry spring was really previously underappreciated before this drought in 2021. Of course, a warm spring that contributed to faster than usual snow melt had always been on my radar. But this was really a different sort of drought than we have seen in recent years with this dry spring. So here are the modeled soil moisture as at the end of May. So you can see in these parts of Eastern Washington here, we had less than the second percentile in terms of our soil moisture. This is the surface, but we saw the same conditions at the root zone. And then of course, adding fuel to the fire, so to speak, we had an unprecedented heat wave in June, 2021. That really had wide-ranging impacts across sectors. So, you know, public health, forests, the marine ecosystems, infrastructure even. This is just from a recent paper showing the maximum three-day maximum temperature anomalies during that warm period in 2021, showing anomalies like above 14 degrees Celsius for 3 days in Washington, which is just very, very intense. But the rest of this presentation, I'm going to be focusing on agriculture. Excuse me. So there were really significant drought impacts to the agriculture sector in 2021. Dryland ag was particularly hit hard with reduced yields in wheat and pulse crops. In early 2022, the Washington State Department of Agriculture distributed a survey to wheat producers to try to understand soil management practices and the impacts of the 2021 drought. So they partnered with entities like the Washington State Grain Commission, the Washington Association of Wheat Growers to help distribute the survey. And they actually got a pretty good response. So 97 dryland wheat producers responded to the survey, and they're at these locations here in Washington. In Eastern Washington, where also note we saw the driest soil moisture or the lowest soil moisture percentiles in 2021. So in terms of our survey result, or the Washington State Department of Ag survey results, the impacts were nearly universal to dryland producers in Washington, with most respondents noting either reduced yields or reduced crop quality. A smaller percentage, but still really significant, reported total crop loss. And then I'll also note that these are just some of the responses. We cut it for time's length for this presentation. And then from the USDA NAS data, the 2021 wheat yields were over 40% below the five-year average for Washington State. I also wanted to note this increased soil erosion was reported by 11% of respondents. And while this is a relatively small number, it can have serious consequences for food production and climate change, as the surface soils can store the highest concentration of crop nutrients and carbon. So then nearly all of the producers reported that a significant driver of drought, so 95% actually, was reduced soil moisture. So the other thing that this survey gave the Washington State Department of Agriculture the opportunity to ask about a variety of conservation practices. So this table summarizes the benefits from four different practices. So that's listed on the top here. And note that for this, the questions were asked to the producers in general about these practices, not directly related to the 2021 drought, but the Washington State Department of Ag still learns that over 70% of reduced or no-till farmers reported improved soil moisture from that practice. Note that cover cropping was also indicated to improve soil moisture. reduced or no-till and adding organic matter were reported to increase yields as well. So the question my colleagues are asking now is, if conservation practices can improve soil moisture and yields, are there ways to get these practices more accessible to farmers and increase adoption? So they also asked about motivations for and barriers to reduced or no-till. And the top responses for the motivators included improved soil health. So 86% noted that as a motivator, reduced cost, 51%, and then the need to adapt to climate change was a lower percentage at 36%. They also were able to ask the farmers, what are the barriers to reduce tillage? And they heard that reducing tillage isn't practical for all operations. It may be necessary for weed control or to reduce soil compaction. Additionally, expenses showed up as both a motivator and a barrier for this practice. And these can vary, of course, from farm to farm and regionally. For example, some areas may have cooperatives available to share equipment and associated costs, while others don't. And then the access to technical assistance from conservation districts and NRCS is also variable. So I also wanted to just touch base on the reported barriers to cover cropping, which are very different from those for reduced till. So only 3% of respondents practice cover cropping, and they really mentioned that those barriers are related to lack of annual precipitation, practicality, and then information availability was the big one. So overall, this survey provided an opportunity to learn from producers at the state level. What does the state need to do to increase adoption of these conservation practices in light of sort of this different flavor of drought, which we've seen in Washington before, we just haven't seen in recent years. And they really identified the two biggest opportunities are potentially additional funding for stuff like no-till equipment, and then more technical support, especially for cover cropping. So then I just wanted to circle back to the heat impacts. So, you know, at the start of the drought or at the start of the irrigation season, water supply was looking good for our irrigated crops, and most of our impacts were to dry land. But that changed with the heat wave. Of course, even with adequate water supply, heat demand is increased through increased evapotranspiration and water used for heat mitigation for crops, for example. So there were all sorts of impacts to even our irrigated crops. Berries shriveled, they were sunburnt, some even cooked on the plant before harvest, causing berries to be too soft to be picked. Red raspberry yields were reduced by 30% due just to the heat. Cherries were too ripe to harvest in some cases. Apples were reduced in size due to heat stress. And then potatoes were also impacted. They stopped growing between about 90 and 95 degrees. The yields were reduced by about 10%. Quality went down, and there was also storage concerns. And so this is all coming from my partners at the Washington State Department of Ag. So just to conclude, the onset of the agricultural drought in the spring of 2021 was driven by dry conditions, extremely low soil moisture in the spring. It was unexpected for those of us monitoring the situation at the state level, and was further made worse by a record-breaking heat wave in June. The larger rivers like the Columbia, larger irrigation districts tended to do better than the smaller systems and dryland ag. The Department of Ag learned some lessons by surveying dryland wheat producers. The reduced yields and reduced crop quality were very widespread in 2021. But then they also saw that reduced till and cover cropping had the largest benefits for increasing soil moisture, but learned that there are some barriers to adopt these practices. And finally, essentially no sector was spared from the impacts of the heat wave, including irrigated ag. And with that, I'll close.
Thank you, Karen. So we have a minute or two for questions. So if anyone has a question for Karen, so go ahead and ask. Oh, Okay, we'll start over here.
My mic on. Yeah. Western Region Climate Services Director at NOAA. We've been having a conversation about kind of words, and I'm curious if in Washington State with this event, are a lot of the producers were they calling it, or do they call it now a flash drought? Have you from the state climate office all called it a flash drought, or they just call it drought or heat wave? You know, how do they characterize the event?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I really haven't heard flash drought used with this event at all until I was invited to talk about this event for this workshop. So at the state level and from producers, that's not really how they're referring to it. And it's an open question, I guess, in my book, whether it can be defined as flash drought or just a different type of drought.
Thank you. Okay, one more question.
Hey, this is Sumit Sharma from Oklahoma State University. My question is that, you know, conservation tillage practices or cover cropping system, it takes some time to see their, you know, impacts on soil health. In your survey, did these producers indicated like how long they were, you know, using these practices to realize their benefits?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I don't know the answer to that. I know that the survey had a lot more questions than what we picked out for this talk, but I can certainly get in touch with my colleagues at Ag and find out.
All right, thank you again, Karen. So we will move on to our next presenter, who is Pablo Speneman. Pablo holds a PhD in atmospheric sciences, and he is currently a researcher at the Argentinian National Meteorological Service. We thank him for making the long journey to share his experience. And he'll be talking about 2017-2018 flash drought event in Argentina, characteristics, impacts, and lessons learned.
Does it work? Okay, good morning. It's very nice to be here. So this case study, we presented this study in the Global Assessment Report on Droughts in 2021, sorry. And it was on a drought that happened in the Argentinian Pampas, and it was motivated by a project, this drought information system for Southern South America, which is it's called CISA for its Spanish acronyms. It's a project of the WMO Regional Climate Center for Southern South America. And it's involved of six of these countries: Bolivia, Chile, Brazil, Paraguay, and Uruguay. And the main objectives of these projects are to produce and disseminate data, information, knowledge, and tools on droughts that allow people, communities, and governments of Southern South America to reduce the impacts of this phenomenon through improvements in monitoring, early warning, preparation, and planning, mainly focused on these three sectors: agriculture, hydro energy, and fluvial navigation, which are of major importance in the region. So the Argentinian Pampas is one of the world's main breadbaskets. Argentina is currently the leading world exporter of soybean oil and meal, and the third global exporter of soy as beans. And agriculture, the practice is mainly rain-fed. Only 3% of the area is under irrigation, which makes the region particularly vulnerable to droughts. Here you can see the region, yes, of the Argentine Pampas. So at the moment of this event, it was only considered a major drought, as there were no previous studies on the region of flash droughts. This was later on confirmed in a paper by Kucharuk at all. And this event was linked to a mild La Niña event combined to some intra-seasonal modes of atmospheric variability. And several locations in the Pampa showed historical precipitation deficits compounded by high temperatures and heat waves during early 2018. And dryness intensified during February 2018. And by mid-March, large areas in the Pampa showed severe, extreme, and exceptional drought conditions, as we can see from the SPI 3 for March. And we can see on the right, the temporal evolution of the SPEI for five locations, showing how the evolution of this drought was. In particular, this SPEI 3, it's updated every 5 days. So it can account more quickly for the rapid changes. And looking at the temporal evolution of this event based on the evaporative stress index, we can see that in early December, there were on the Argentinian Pampas, there were no signal, but in February and March in the upper right, there were a clearly signal of the drought, and which reaches peak of intensity in March of 2018. And then it evolved from April to May to normal conditions. So this it was a flash drought analyzing this 14 locations within the Argentine Pampas. It was a flash drought we confirmed that it was a flash drought using the flash drought intensification index, applying it to the ERA 5 land soil moisture simulations. And on the right figure, we can see the temporal evolution of the soil moisture percentiles over the red locations, which showed to be the most severe flash droughts conditions of the whole period analyzing over 40 years, yeah, considering the 1981-2020 period. So 7 of them showed the most severe conditions for a flash drought. There were also two locations that showed the highest soil moisture intensification. And the after intensification period coincided with the corn growing critical period, which, as I'm going to show later, it had a lot of impacts on yields. In addition, flash drought represent 40% of all drought event with a significant frequency increase in the last 20 years, this period that we analyzed. So talking about the impacts, major impacts were on summer crop yields, as I mentioned before, specifically on corn and soy, and when propagated throughout Argentinian's economy, there were crop losses that were about $1,550 million, with an overall impact, with considering the cascading impact, over 3 times higher. Although crop prices were relatively high at the moment, which helped to reduce a little bit the economical impacts. Soybean production was 31% lower than on both the previous and following cycles. Short cycle soybean was most affected. Soil water had been consumed by the preceding crop and was not replenished by rainfall during the austral summer. In particular, corn production was 13% and 23% lower than on the previous and following cycles. And most of the lost production, 7.5 million tons, was suffered by late zone corn. And here in this figure in the left, here we can see in red is the estimations in dots of the corn based by the agriculture ministry and the simulations by using ensemble simulation of yields using different crop management, different initial conditions of soil moisture and different soil characteristic for each of the location that I showed early. And in the blue one, we can see the same but for soy. And we can see here that it was in gray. That was this event and with the clearly impact that it had on particularly on corn. The impacts on cattle were lower than on previous droughts because of the production systems intensification. There were more cattle in feedlots where forage is externally produced. 8 provinces, which means states, declared agricultural emergency or agricultural disaster. The government reaction in declaring agricultural emergency was relatively fast. They did it some of the states with a mark in red in the left figure. Did declare the emergency in April and May. So it was very fast. And 1.1 million hectares were affected by fire, principally in the western part of the Argentine Pampas. And conservative estimates suggest that Argentina's gross net product decreased at least 0.8 due to this flash drought. So which were the lessons learned? This event helped in the creation at the national level of the SINAGIR, which is the National System for Disaster Risk Reduction and Civil Protection, an important institutional framework for coordination and planning on a broad spectrum of geophysical risk. Within the SINAGIR framework, a network was established linking science and technology institutions linked to the management of various climate and geophysical risk. This network is called the GIRCIT in Spanish. The GIRCIT facilitated the design of an interinstitutional protocol to manage information about meteorological and agricultural droughts in Argentina. And this protocol motivated the formation of a drought monitoring roundtable, which is playing a crucial role in coordinating the separate and sometimes overlapping efforts of governmental and academic institutions involved in droughts. Here are 2 examples also. This is one of the reports made by the drought monitoring roundtable, where there are analyzed the different variables, precipitation, soil moisture, and also the different regions which are under risk. And also the CISA project started providing visualization of the evaporative stress index after this event. And this is a current image, the latest image of the ESI. And finally, lessons learned. Okay, I spoke with Maria Estrada, which is a practitioner at the Agricultural Ministry of Argentina, and she coordinates the drought monitoring roundtable. And we were talking about comparing this flash drought event and the following extreme and long-term drought that affected the region. And she told me that last year in October, they spoke with different decision makers of the ministry to tell everyone how critical the actual agricultural scenario was. However, no mitigation actions were taken. And she told me that just when you have time to act, the slow drought evolution seemed to hinder, in this case, the early alerts, in this case and in Argentina, hinder the early alerts and actions. Thus, the time to act is clearly not the only variable for mitigate the drought impacts. So, thank you.
Thank you, Pablo, for bringing this international perspective. We really appreciate it. All right, does anyone have a question for Pablo? I realize I've neglected our online audience too, and I haven't been asking if they have questions.
We do not have any questions right now.
Okay, great. Does anyone else have a question for Pablo before we move on to the next activity? Yeah.
Thanks, Pablo. Very good talk. Had an interest in work with CISA actually, so it's good to have you here. Mike, if you could go back to that last slide, I think it really captures audience. Yeah, where you talked about just when you have time to act, the slow drought evolution seemed to hinder, in this case, early alerts and actions. I think that's the crux of why we use this terminology a little bit of flash drought and getting people to act on it before we're 1, 2, 3 years down the road and, you know, we've stuck our head in the sand. So I just want to, that observation from the folks you've worked with on the ground there is awesome to bring to us here for perspective. So appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
And apologies, I think we actually did have an online question if we still have time.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, Richard, did you have a question? Okay, so Richard is asking, he's curious if the droughts in Argentina are related to La Nina.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Easy answer. All right.
We don't know if they are related to the flash droughts, but to the droughts, yes. Yes.
Thank you so much, Pablo. Okay.
All right, now it's time to have a little fun. I'm going to do some reorganizing here. For our next kind of way to chew through the material that we've acquired today, we're going to use a tabletop type exercise for the next 70 minutes or so, which will require each table to have at least 4, preferably 5, people at the table. So most of the tables are in good shape. I think, Becky, I'm going to have to make you an art move. I'm so. Could you join either this table here? I think that would work. And then, Hailan, I think your table, if the three of you, and Maggie, if you could disperse a bit and join another table, that should balance this out pretty well. I'm just gonna do a quick survey here. All right, come on folks, let's move. we're gonna make this work. What I loved about the case studies, Carson, is that we could actually see a look back to previous droughts for many folks, some recognition that flash drought or rapid onset happened, maybe rapid intensification as well, and an adaptation of planning strategies, of plans, of operational responses, communications tools. And I think we now, with the material that we've gathered from the previous sessions, we're making that progression toward active response.
Yeah, I agree. I think it was really great to see the variety of examples and also the examples of what the practitioners are doing on the ground. And I think we can learn kind of both directions from those case studies.
Great, great. All right. Looks like we're all in place with some good discussion groups coming here. What we're going to do is use the Slido tool to help us capture some more thoughts about, particularly about these case studies and what you liked and maybe things you want to implement with in your own agencies or want to make sure you're touching base with your partners so that they can have some new plans and implementation ideas in place. And we're going to cover two questions in our little table groups. And I'll let Carson describe how we're going to do that. It's a process called 1-2 table all, or I think Carson, you had another name for it.
We also call it think, pair, share.
Think, pair, share.
Okay, so what we're gonna do is on your own, so individually, you're gonna answer the first question. So grab a pencil or pen if you have it and just jot down some ideas. I'm gonna give you a minute and I'm gonna time it on my phone. After a minute, we'll have you talk to your neighbor and share out what you did, and then we'll tell you what happens next. But eventually we'll get the groups talking together and then sharing out. But you're going to just start on your own. So just individually.
Carson, excuse me for interrupting. Could you actually go through the whole thing for the people in the virtual audience?
Because
they're going to be going off on their own breakout.
Sure. Okay. Yes. So you're going to, so the first minute, you're going to do it on your own. So you're going to answer the first question that we will have up on the screen here. And then for the next, I think, 3 minutes, 3 or 4 minutes, you're going to turn to your partner and share out what you wrote down. And then as a table or in breakout rooms online, you're going to discuss amongst yourselves what you came up with related to this question. And then you'll come back. We'll come back to this main group in person and also the main group online, and then go ahead and share out what your each table came up with as their responses to the question. Any questions on that?
Okay, and I think maybe Molly, your process is a little bit different with the virtual attendees. How many people do you have with you today?
You know, right now we have about 20 people. So I will kind of give them the rundown of how we'll do the virtual side once we're in the breakout room, which we will move to now.
Thank you. Good luck. Enjoy.
Great. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay. Oop, I'm going to go back. All right, there's our first question. Carson?
So from what you've heard in this session and previously, what components or component needs the most attention to improve our response and actions during a flash drought? So I'm going to give you a minute to think about this on your own. Seconds. All right, finish writing whatever you were just jotting down. And once you're done with that, go ahead and turn to your neighbor and tell them what you came up with, and we'll give you a couple minutes to do that.
Just clarifying, you would share with one other person right now, turn to a pair. Okay, chatty chatty, make sure you're pairing up, everybody.
Yeah, it is. It is. It really, especially at first. And when you do it the second time. Yeah.
but it's another little slice of him dice. So I'm going to look at things. I'm going to be picking up one other, modifying it, maybe, and then it gets bigger, and then it just amazing frames.
Well, and I like it too because then people who don't normally talk get to sometimes they have really important things to say.
It's another way to have them get an opportunity to feel comfortable.
Yeah.
To be here. Share.
I like the coffee discussion. Like the format today is really nice.
Let's see how this slide opens.
I'll be curious. A lot of pressure on me.
It is to keep up. Uh-oh, she's sending me another posting note. I'm in trouble again.
Is that your communication?
Well, I'm not Utah, and she is, and we will set up a camera weekend, and I'm not. So I really can't. I'm not getting the communication. So we're going to old school. Pass a note. No, that's not my note. I guess I'm okay. I guess we're all right.
Should we cut down on the group time? I know we're a little more. I had 10 minutes allotted, but maybe we should do like 8 minutes or something.
We only have two questions,
yeah.
So let's see how the table goes and make a decision. Because we just had a break and people ate. And
yeah.
We should be able to get until noon, okay. And get both questions done at all three levels.
Okay.
It kind of depends on, yeah, how that all is going to go.
Yeah, the table show.
Mm-hmm. For sure. No more than, what did we say, 8 minutes for the all? Or did we, 10, table 10.
Yeah.
And she's typing. Yeah, we might have to cut that, like shave it back to 8 or something like that, but we'll see how it goes. Everybody's going on.
Yeah. Really nice having Molly online, be able to like coordinate that.
That makes things.
I feel like they're being represented.
If you're taking the time out of your day to join us, and we want to get your input. I know that one comment from Brad Ribby is really awesome. Yeah.
Okay, we've got 20 seconds. Like it's.
That's perfect. Thank you. That's a good idea to put the mic next to the phone.
Otherwise, we'll just chat.
Yeah.
Okay, everybody. Pause your conversation for a moment. Raise your hand if you can hear me. Raise your hand if you can hear me. All right, all right. This is great. Okay, so now you're gonna move from just your partner you were sharing with to the full table. And perhaps you can also in that time nominate the person who's gonna share out. So after this, we're gonna give you about 10 minutes to share amongst your tables. And then we'll have each group share out to the broader group. And Marina's gonna be taking down your notes once we share out to the broader group. So let's take the next 10 minutes to share amongst your tables.
Which probably already happened.
For the next one. Well, we probably don't. I was going to say we could be able to do the needles, but I think that's from.
Yeah, I had a hard time getting them.
You know, like that group of people, they all know you have it very well. I know they do.
Right. We need to break
you
up.
You know, and like get the grad students involved, you know.
Yeah,
like,
you're right. Let's see.
I don't know if we have time, but we could just.
And to make that, I. Maureen is going to show me. How much time do we have?
Oh,
we
stopped. No, wait, here we go. We got
six minutes. Let me go and see what she thinks about that. Okay.
All right, you've got 5 more minutes at your tables to keep chatting.
And there's some point to get that done. After our workshop, it goes through Thursday and then Friday is like, you know, I'm trying. For me, yeah.
I mean, we can run the workshop. Want to announce that and then I'll do the move around.
I just did 5 minutes, but do you want me to?
At 2 minutes, maybe.
We'll just cut it.
Yeah. It actually looks,
it's not like smart.
Yeah. I think we should change it. Just, okay.
All right, 1 minute warning. All right, finish those sentences and nominate who's going to be the person who will be sharing out to the larger group. Yeah, sounds good. All right, raise your hand if you can hear me. All right, thank you, everyone. So we're going to go ahead and just go around the room. So why don't we start with this table? And as you're sharing out, we're going to pass around a mic so we can hear you. And Marina's going to be writing down what you say. So please maybe make it succinct so she can write it in the Slido, and then we're going to have it show up on the screen. So let us know what were some of the things that you all came up with. We're getting a microphone to you in a moment.
All right, so kind of what we were talking about here is, you started out talking about, you know, like the modeling, the data that we're getting. So using that data, understanding that data, what it's telling us as far as helping us, you know, decide on predicting, you know, so our soil moisture, our temperatures, our precipitation on a daily basis, on a local or on a weekly, you know, monitoring that data so that we know if we're, you know, coming into a flash drought, and being able to communicate that out to producers, municipalities, things like that. Also, not only getting data, you know, or responding on a local level, but, you know, as we were just watching in the Argentina presentation, how this affects stuff globally. So yeah, you know, flash drought can happen, you know, on a local smaller scale, but we just saw it, you know, within Argentina's situation, it happened over, you know, multiple countries, mm-hmm. you know, and being part of the bigger part of a breadbasket, you can collapse, you know, food, you know, global food securities type of thing. So not only local, but we need, you know, the vulnerabilities of global, the possibility of global flash drought as well. Mm. And then, you know, having those drought plans in place, I think, you know, what we found through a lot of these talks is we don't have those plans in place until after the fact. So rather than being retrospective, like, okay, let's have something in place so that we can respond better. But then also at the same time, after we do respond, you know, managing that plan, okay, what worked, what didn't work, and moving on it from there. And then I think, you know, one of the things that we're taking away from most of this the conference so far is we don't have a lot of baseline information. Mm. So getting that kind of information, you know, before, during, and after, so that we're better prepared and maybe I'll understand like the modeling and the data better as it applies to us. So that's kind of what we were talking about.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. We'll move on to the next table. Who's going to go ahead and share. Thank you.
Hi, as if you haven't heard my voice enough today. So definitely building on what the first table just expressed, during a flash drought, a question I often get from folks in the field is, how long do we expect this to last? Is this literally going to be a flash that I can just get through, or might this turn into something longer? Also wanting to know in the moment, who and how is being, who is being affected and how? Like, we feel like we still don't have a great understanding for most of our sectors about how flash drought in particular is actually affecting them. And that made us think, we need more people to use Seymour. And so anything we can do to make Seymour more accessible for those first time users, make sure they're not overwhelmed by too many checkboxes, would be helpful so that we can document how they're being impacted. The second theme from our group was kind of that social element and the importance of having people in the field to experience that social, important social element. So having the people capacity to be able to build relationships with our stakeholders so that we can understand how they're being impacted or what their vulnerabilities are. We can hear their language and how they talk about the impacts of flash drought and describe it. And then having, you know, again, building those relationships for effective response and preparedness. And then the longer term, what do we know about the frequency and likelihood of flash drought in our regions and how that's changing because of climate change?
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Marina, for getting all of this down.
Hello. So a few topics at our table. Try to be as succinct as I can. One that came up is, you know, development of state plans that are better suited for faster response. A lot of state drought management plans, including ours in Connecticut, are geared for a longer time scale in terms of response. And so maybe it's time to start integrating state drought management plans with emergency management plans and bringing in some of the tool sets from emergency management agencies to be able to allow those plans and those planning functions to have quicker response times and faster time scales for flash drought. Another topic on monitoring and data sets, just the maintenance, the importance of maintaining current tools for monitoring the progress of drought and developing, research, new tools that allow states and regulators, practitioners to oversee or to monitor the unfolding of a flash drought in real time or as close to real time as possible. You know, one of the limitations that we've talked about is with a lot of the monitoring tools only having, you know, biweekly or monthly releases of new updates, but having faster information at our fingertips would be very beneficial. And then lastly, there's better communication of the risks to the public and those stakeholders who are affected in terms of integrating forecasting tools into what we're seeing to be able to come up with a more of a probabilistic forecast of, you know, what's the likelihood of this worsening versus getting better, and what are the confidence intervals and ways to really communicate that effectively to the public so that they understand it's not black and white. There's varying levels of confidence in terms of how this is going to evolve. So those are a few things from our table.
Awesome, thank you. And if you do want to thumbs up any of these as they're coming up, you can go to slido.com on your phone or computer, or you can scan the QR code and you can see on the right, we're getting some thumbs up for some of these. So we can kind of see which ones are high priority for folks in the room. All right, next table.
So we have four very succinct points that we have summarized our discussion at. So the first thing that came up was real-time or near real-time low latency drought monitoring with as big an extent as possible live forecast. That means we are having a forecast getting updated within a very short duration, but we are leading up to maybe 1 week or 2 week in advance. And the forecasts are being updated every day or as low latency as possible, just like our weather apps get updated every day. The third point is a public open source dashboard for impact assessment and resource dissemination. A lot of state resources, US Drought Monitor, have that already, but they are not available for the for several upcoming resources or the newly developed tools. So we might need a dashboard for that kind of impact assessment and resource dissemination as well. And the fourth is on the action side. So we are in favor of a contingency action plan for communication with the state stakeholders at state and county level for quicker, faster, and more efficient action. Thank you.
Thank you. It's great to hear all these ideas. I feel like we're having a very diverse set of ideas coming out. Thank you.
I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm getting tired of sitting around, so I thought I'd stand.
Perfect.
So our table here, what we thought about is to add on to some of the things that have already been said is we've got to communicate better. Not only communicate to the public, but we also have to communicate up to the interagencies and the other people that work in drought and across the whole federal and state agencies. One of the other big things that was already mentioned is we need some better real-time forecasting of what really is a flash drought. And you know, we need to make sure that the public understands when we say flash drought, what do we mean? Is it only going to be a last for a few days, or is it going to last for a month? Is it going to go into a severe drought, or what does it really mean when we say flash drought? And then also the biggest thing that we talked about is a dedicated communication plan of how we're going to communicate that information to others across the area that we're interested in. Like Stephanie already said here from California, that the state has a process put in place that if they understand that it's going to be a drought coming, they can stand up a committee to look at it immediately. So that's what we came up here. Thanks.
So yeah, I would just add, I mean, really from our table's perspective, a lot of the comments that have been provided up to this point, I feel pretty well characterized the information that was discussed amongst our group. One of the things that was noted kind of early on in the discussion was the difficulty in determining when flash drought begins in an actual event. So if there was any sort of way or opportunity to get further information sharing or development on real-time monitoring, forecasting, and impact systems, we felt that that could be a value to overall flash drought monitoring and response. Another thing too, kind of on the forecasting side of things is, and it gets to a number of the discussions that have taken place over the context of the last 2 days, is the end portion of an event. I guess the benefits or needs on forecasting tools to help characterize short or long-term potential of a current event. There was recognition of the need and value of that. And then really a good portion of our discussion kind of centered around the communication side of this overall discussion as well. So making sure that the right individuals and organizations are at the table at multiple levels, and recognizing too that practitioners in a lot of cases will see the impacts first. So get those on the ground to help report impacts. And some of the ideas that emerged from our group discussion looked at trying to mobilize some of the ag commodity or advocacy groups within respective states. One of the things too that I think has been mentioned in a number of discussions as well is kind of the public water supply or water supply impacts, and engaging with some of those organizations at multiple levels and extension and federal agencies. So that was noted as kind of the practitioner and some of the groups that we would look to engage. And then on the information exchange, a good portion of the discussion really kind of centered on kind of the Massachusetts and South Carolina examples when it came to fact sheets and infographics. Mm-hmm. Being able to share that information in kind of quick and concise formats will help with some of that information exchange as well. So that was something that was highlighted at our table. Thank you.
Thank you. And I know we have four more tables to get through, and we have another question. So let's try and be really concise on these next ones so we can get to that next question.
All right, I'll try and be as concise as possible here. So a lot of the same thing that we've heard already, just our table's flavor on it. Really getting at the so what and why do we care? Using impacts to articulate why it matters and what may be coming with a flash drought. And relating that to management and how that would change flash droughts work differently than kind of the traditional slow creeping phenomenon that most state entities or local entities are used to dealing with droughts. So then how do we adaptively manage those situations? And then communicating about that, both in terms of the impacts, the so what, and then why management is changing compared to what we're normally used to. And then from data side of it, using better data for flash drought, what data is needed. So understanding what data is needed that and pertinent for flash drought in specific regions and then different sectors and how that can be used for the communication, the management, and the response.
Wonderful, thank you.
Hello, just a quick question to the technical staff and maybe Marina as well. We're only seeing the top five. Can we scroll through the Slido at all? Can we see more of the inputs from Marina only at one off. Time? Yeah. Nope, maybe not.
All right.
There we go. Oh. Thank you.
Sure. All right. Again, a lot of echoing of what we heard from other people. We basically, ours kind of consolidated under data, but from two ways. The first thing is like actual, I'll call it meteorological data, right? So on that side of things, and issues of data latency, how quickly can we get the data since we're looking at fast onset, noise in the data, so variations perhaps masking any quick trends, masking those downward things that we're looking for, and then also potentially averaging if we're, looking at running means over 2 weeks. So kind of ideas of data that we need to get that fast kind of movement of things. And then on the second thing, like everyone said, impacts, knowing how the impacts of a flash drought are different from what we'd seen a normal drought would be really the thing to guide our response.
Excellent.
Last but not least.
I'll be real brief. Basically, not all drought is the same, and timing is everything when it comes to drought. That's pretty much what's been discussed here. We need people on the ground providing information, as well as the digital, any type of digital real-time types of information that have to be integrated. And if I were to kind of describe it really succinctly, in the big during a flash drought, we need to move the needle. In the hydrological cycle graphic that I think most of us are familiar with, we need to move that needle quicker because it's fast. The flash drought moves at a faster rate. We need to move that needle quicker from apathy to awareness. And whatever we can do across the board to do that is what is really needed during flash drought. And one last thing, everybody talks about flash drought and its negative impacts. There are positive impacts of flash drought. So something to also consider, for example, if you are harvesting something or work in construction, dry is actually pretty good.
Good point. Thank you. We have one more.
From our table, we also talked about the need for continuous monitoring and prediction. Really to push the limits of predictability for flash drought. Other ways, we talked about communication and coordination, the need to reach stakeholders using various channels like social media and briefings, and also to convene bodies like drought management panels at the level where there's authority to make decisions. So in the US, that's usually at the state level.
Wonderful. Thank you all for these ideas. And thank you, Marina, for capturing them so we can look
at
them.
We also, later. Virtual audience.
Thank you. Yes.
Yes. Actually, really, I was just going through the selections and all of our comments are captured, which is the ability to incorporate flash drought into a drought preparedness plan. So that's already on the list. Also, knowing which impacts are important to various sectors, that is on the list as well. And also having a monitoring tool that really gets at the rapid intensification so we don't miss anything. So all of our main ideas are captured already on the Slido. So just wanted to mention that.
Thank you so much for chiming in. And I'm gonna turn it over to Sylvia, who's gonna take over for the next question.
Before we do the next question, think of your table as an island. I think you know where I'm going with this. You are about to vote two people off your island, and we're going to mix this little discussion up just a little bit more. So what I'm asking is two people from this table move to that table. We're going to see some climate drought forced migration going on here. So quickly, two people from each table move to the next table. And then we'll hit that second question and head to lunch.
And virtual audience, we will move to the breakout room right now.
Okay. Thank you so much for going ahead and making that move. And we're considering that first question, the second question, and in the mode where we're thinking in our heads. You can jot down what your thoughts are if you need to do that or would like to do that. But go ahead and have that inner conversation.
So your 1 minute is up. So you're going to do what you did last time and turn to your neighbor and just talk to one other person about what you just put down.
All right, and if you haven't started sharing with your larger table, go ahead and start sharing with your larger table. All right, so finish up your conversations at your tables. We're gonna do a similar process as last time, except one caveat, we're gonna have each table share one
thing. We're kind of running out of time, so we're not going to be able to share as many per table. So pick your one thing that you really want to share that came up in your table and take 1 minute to decide that, and then we'll start sharing with the room.
All right, this time we're going to start on this side of the room, right side, my right, your left. And your leader, Hailan, at your table, who is that?
Yeah, so one thing we talked about a lot, but I'm going to go with, since I have it, the predictive indicators. We need to know what those indicators are that better predict so we can better prepare.
Yes.
So our group or our table talked about adaptation mechanisms and needs to know what the stakeholder needs and types of impacts.
Mm-hmm. So we talked a little bit about trying to learn from past impacts and responses and the responses we wish we had may have taken, you know, with the benefit of hindsight. And we also talked a little bit about maybe developing, you know, tabletop exercises or, you know, learning from emergency management where you can practice these events in a lower stress environment rather than trying to do it during the crisis moment.
So Joe just stole our thunder on postmortem on past drought events. So I'm going to move to looking at drought plans, you know, where states implement actions based on, you know, indicator levels or what have you, but they have a drought plan. So we need to adjust those drought plans to incorporate faster onset droughts, specific actions to indicator levels again, and also use it to develop in infrastructure planning to develop drought resilient systems and thinking, that sort of resilient thinking inside our infrastructure planning, the key to rapid onset droughts.
I will keep it very short on ours. And our one big thing is kind of a combination of all of our discussion, and that would be better data for real-time analysis and historical assessment purposes to advance partner coordination on overall planning and preparedness. One big thing.
Mouthful.
So our group talked about not only knowing ahead of time which indicators and data is best suited for your region or sector, right, to predict flash drought, but also knowing ahead of time where you're going to look for that impacts data, you know, as flash drought is occurring or after it occurs, so you can react right away. Where am I going to find those impacts?
And the Jason Atkin fan club is getting going with a thumbs up there.
So what our group mentioned was similar to, well, I guess, a couple other groups, but it's the need to, if you have a drought plan, to exercise that drought plan, to test it with a drought scenario to make sure that it is adequately preparing you for the timing and severity of some of the drought impacts. So.
Yeah, we got Jason. We got it already. People talk about planning. Yeah, proactive mitigation drought plan with a plan assessment, post-event assessment, including thinking about resilience measures, and then regular meetings outside of drought time because people change, things change, and the plan looks completely different when the next one hits.
All
All right, so we also had tabletop discussions, but something to add here is establishing connections with folks. And part of that tabletop discussion is figuring out your blind spots and figuring out who you need to connect with. We also discussed kind of how flash routes can propagate, cascade through the system. So looking at social, economic teleconnections, so down the line impacts. And so maybe flash routes are not happening in your region, but it can, the impacts can spill over into your particular area.
Good point.
Hi, we talked about determining which impacts specifically are going to be taking place with rapid drought events versus just regular drought, figuring out what measures you can take for those, and then how to shift that response as you maybe move into a more long-term drought.
Thank you. Everybody give yourself a nice little hand there. Well done.
Virtual.
Yes, and Molly, go ahead.
Quickly, so our conversation really was around the authority to implement actions might not be given to you, or they don't happen fast enough. So really it's around you can't do anything or you can't act fast enough for flash drought. So it's more of a policy side. And the emergency management structure for authorities has proven helpful in some areas. So implementing that in other areas. So that's kind of the idea of the emergency management structure.
Thank you, Molly. That's great. Mm-hmm. So as we go through getting into lunch here in the main room in the plenary session, I want you to go ahead and use those social media thumbs and start loading up your Slido preferences there. Maybe we could take a look at the top three responses from our Slido poll. Never mind. How about number two, drought plans. Adjust them to incorporate flash drought and also use for infrastructure planning to build resilience. Kind of good consensus on that from the room. All right. Adaptation mechanisms. What do your stakeholders need to prepare and respond, knowing the beforehand? Continuous meetings, I heard. Learn from past events to better be prepared for the next, and opportunities to actually practice. I know there have been some out in the Pacific Northwest, I want to say, help me here, Britt, or maybe Meredith, some actual drought exercises that have taken place. Yeah, so maybe we can have that chat as we go into our lunch. And thank you again, everybody online in the virtual world and in the plenary room here in Boulder. I think this has been a great way to discuss what we've heard so far. We'll see you on the backside of lunch.